Good morning. I'm Reverend Amelia Richardson Dress, and along with our entire worship team, with Reverend Sarah, with Parker, Robert, we have Tim and Ginny and Simon here on music with us today. I just want to welcome each of you, whether you are joining us here in the sanctuary in person, or if you are joining us one of the ways that you can join from home. We are so happy to be together. on this morning. You'll notice behind me our setup looks a little different. Today we have an Easter pageant, which is like a Christmas pageant, but at Easter as we continue our celebration of the resurrection. This is intergenerational, and you will get to hear more about how that came together and how that will look a little later on. But thank you for being here for that. This is a new thing for us today. One of the central cornerstones of this church and of the United Church of Christ denomination is that no matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. So as you settle in, take a moment to breathe into that spirit, to be connected to the people that are forming this community with us today, and to know that you are held in the presence of God.
And this morning, as our celebration of resurrection continues, we light the way for places in our world where there is despair, that there may be hope, where there is discord, that there may be peace, where there is uncertainty, that there may be gentle trust, that a way will be provided. And friends, I invite you to light your candle, either one that you physically have with you or one that you may hold in your imagination or your memory. What is it that's on your heart today where you need light, or where you would ask the light of our living God to be present? And in the presence of light, I invite you now to join in these gathering words as they appear on your screen or are printed in your bulletin. Soul behind all souls, at the breaking of dawn, at the coming of day, we wait and watch. Your light within the morning light, your soul within the human soul, your presence beckoning to us from the heart of life. In the dawning of this day, let us know fresh shinings in our soul. In the growing colors of new beginnings all around us, let us know the first lights of our heart. Amen.
So as I mentioned in our welcome, today we have an Easter pageant, which is just some of the stories of the resurrection that are not the Easter morning stories. They're not the stories of the tomb, the discovery of the empty tomb. These are the stories that happen throughout that day and throughout that week. And they're stories that we do not often hear as much. But they come to us with the reminder that the Easter experience continues. That it wasn't just one morning, that people have continued to experience this risen Christ in new ways. One of the things that is central to how we do worship here at UCC Longmont, and that you will notice in the pageant, is that it's intergenerational. That we have actors of all ages, from early elementary school into retirement, who come together to do this. And it's important and also touching to me to see these happen, because it's one way that we play with the stories differently. When we interact with the stories this way, nobody has to be the expert. Nobody has to know what the story means or how to explain it. We just get to experience it together. I also love it because it's how we get to make connections differently across the ages, but it's also something that I think is important, and I'm reminded of something that a friend and colleague, Wendy Claire Berry, often says about Christmas pageants, that it's important to have adults participate in those, because when only children tell the story, we think the story is only for children. And I think that that is also true, but in reverse, for the Easter story, that when only adults tell the story, we think the story is only for adults. But today we will experience and retell and rehear this story in a different way, all of us together. So I hope that you enjoy this. Our reporters from Christmas are back. And in a moment, we will return to our newscast with Just In from Jerusalem.
All right, we're going to sing Morning Has Broken, and y'all are welcome to stand, right? Yeah. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for the spring, fresh from the
Well, hello and welcome back to Channel Zero News, where we cover it all so you don't have to.
Today we have a special investigation series. Our reporters are somewhere near Jerusalem covering reports of a man raised from the dead.
And as your number one news source, you can count on us to leave no stone unturned and no question unasked in our search for the truth.
Let's go first to Harper. She's on location in Emmaus, a small town just outside of Jerusalem.
Welcome to Channel O News. Today we're going to talk about a few people to a few people about Easter. Let's just say that Easter isn't about candy, eggs, and a very cute bunny. Here we have Cleopas and Bob. They're two travelers who met Jesus in disguise. We're going to hear about a very good news story. What happened?
Well, we saw this random guy with a beard who comes up and starts talking to us. How was I supposed to know that it was him? It took the breaking of bread to at least figure out that he wasn't a hitchhiker. It was also kind of awkward because we were talking about him at the time.
Folks, I know this question isn't important, but what kind of bread was it? I need details.
I may be definitely not pumpernickel.
It was whole wheat. And besides, Jesus disappeared after that. Next time I see him, I'm going to hold off on the rolls, if you know what I mean.
Actually, he probably liked bread. He just, I don't know.
One last thing. What was your conversation?
We were talking about him. We were saying how courageous he was and how he has saved millions.
He's like a person who's kind for free.
Thank you. I hope you recover. We will be back after these messages. Oh, and not the vacuum with the one with the catchy music this time. Or Baby Shark. I might have to fire that person who came up with that one.
Well, good news, Harper. Our commercial break was cut short, so there's no Baby Shark and no catchy music, although we are doing some very subtle product placement.
That's right. We love our Ulysses 5000 vacuum so much that we take it everywhere. It's quiet enough that we could have ran it during your report and not missed a thing.
So if your carpets are getting a little more wear and tear with all the time at home, give this one a try.
And if you order in the next 5 minutes, you can use Channel Zero News as a coupon code at checkout for 5% off shipping and handling.
Get your phone out and order now. While you're ordering, you can watch our next interview, where two of our bravest reporters are venturing north to Tiberias.
We're here near the Sea of Tiberias, where we're investigating another unusual sighting. With me is Mr. Peter and his co-workers.
Oh no, I'm not Mr. Peter, it's just Peter.
Oh, I'm sorry. My notes say your name is Simon Peter.
Yeah, people do call me that sometimes, but mostly I go by Peter. It's not a last name, it's my other first name.
Oh, like a middle name?
No, just my other first name.
Oh, like a nickname?
No, just my other first name. See, I used to be Simon, but now it's Peter. So that's confusing for some people. So they call me Simon Peter. And this is Nathaniel, and this is James.
Thanks, Peter. Glad to have you too, Nathaniel and James. Can you tell me a little bit about what happened here a few days ago? You claim you saw a person back from the dead.
Not just any person. I saw Jesus. That's right. After he was killed, and then Mary saw him at the tomb, and some disciples saw him in the upper room, it was a lot to understand. You know, I didn't know whether to be happy or sad or both, so I went fishing with several others of Jesus' followers. We just needed to clear out our heads.
It sounds like such a hard time, and sometimes when people are grieving, they think they see their loved ones. It's understandable.
No, I didn't just think I saw him. I really saw him. We all did. We'd been out fishing most of the night and hadn't caught a thing, not one teeny tiny fish. Early in the morning, we saw someone standing on the shore.
What did he look like?
Looked like any other fisherman. Like someone you'd see walking down a beach on their way to work. Or maybe pass in the marketplace selling their fish. Boy, could he yell, though. He called out to us, "You don't have any fish, do you?" And someone yelled back, "No." And then the man said to put our nets on the other side of the boat.
Did you do it?
Yeah, we figured it was worth a shot. If it worked, we'd be done with our fishing for the day. If it didn't, this guy would leave us alone. Win-win.
And did it work?
Yes. That's when I knew it was Jesus. We pulled the nets back in, and they were full of fish. We'd been fishing all night and hadn't caught anything, but Jesus was always doing miracles, like when he was alive. He could walk on water, get nets full of fish, turn water into wine. I just knew it was him.
Oh, wine, huh? This is all starting to make sense.
I was so excited, I took my clothes off, jumped in the water, and swam all the way to shore. Jesus had already made a fire, so I sat down and warmed up.
And once you got closer, could you tell it was Jesus?
That's the weird thing. He still looked like any old person. He wasn't glowing or anything. If I'd passed him on the street, I probably wouldn't even recognize him. But sitting there, I knew it was him.
Because of the wine?
No, because of the bread and the fish. Jesus cooked fish for us over the fire, and then he took bread from somewhere, and he passed them around to us. Everyone knew it was him then.
Interesting. I've heard about the bread before. What's in your bread?
Well, that's a weird question. Flour, water, yeast, the usual.
Yeah. Oh, wait, my colleague Luglu is asking a question. She wants to know exactly what kind of bread it is. She says she needs details.
It was just bread. Wheat.
But not rolls.
No, not rolls.
And did Jesus disappear after he ate the bread?
Not right away. He had some questions for Peter first.
Jesus had questions for you?
Yeah, he wanted to know if I loved him.
That's an odd question. Why would he ask that?
I'd rather not talk about it. It's a long, sad story.
Okay, well, if you ever change your mind, give us a call. Sounds like it could be a good human interest piece. So what did you tell Jesus when he asked if you loved him?
I told him I did. I had to tell him three times, but each time he just said, feed my sheep.
What? Jesus has sheep too? I thought he was a fisherman, or a baker, or a winemaker. This guy does everything.
It's a metaphor. He meant that I should take care of his people, which is all people.
Oh, okay. And then did you get to ask Jesus any questions? Because I'm about ready for some answers here.
No, after that he disappeared.
Well, if you see this Jesus again, please call us. Better yet, have him call us. I have a list of questions for him, starting with, what's in that bread? If that goes well, I might ask him some of our most pressing questions from viewers, like, what's God like? How will I recognize Jesus? And where is heaven?
Good luck. Many people tried asking him questions like that. He's a hard guy to get an answer out of. Tells a lot of good stories, though.
Seems like you all tell some good stories.
Thanks for your time here today, Peter, James, and Nathaniel. That's it from Lulu and Dwayne in Tiberias for Channel Zero News, where we cover all the news and some things that aren't.
You know, I have been studying this map during that report, and I can't make sense of this itinerary. It looks like Emmaus is down here, and Tiberias is up here, and apparently the Sea of Tiberias is the same thing as the Sea of Galilee, and it's just very confusing.
You know what always helps me think, Amelia? A nice strong cup of tea, which I brewed using the T-Max. Here, try a cup. And while you drink, let's go back to Harper. This time she's just outside of Jerusalem where she's talking to a woman who was one of the first eyewitnesses to the resurrection.
Thanks, Amelia and Sarah. I've got a special video interview today with one of the first eyewitnesses to see these unusual events. Joanna, thanks for joining me today.
You're welcome. I'm happy to be here. And on my way, I ran into Fred. And I invited him to join me. He was near the tomb that morning, and I thought he'd be able to share what he saw as well.
Wonderful. I'm eager to get to the bottom of this, so the more the merrier. Joanna, why don't you start by telling us about that morning?
Well, I went to the tomb with several of my friends. There was Mary Magdalene and Mary, mother of James, and I seem to have forgotten. It's all such a blur, you know? But there were quite a few of us.
And why were you there?
Well, we went to visit our teacher and friend, Jesus.
Fred, what do you remember about that day?
Well, I was actually there out of curiosity. I'd heard these things that Jesus had said, and I wondered if they could be true. I mean, of course, I didn't believe in people coming back from the dead and all that nonsense. But if it was going to happen, I didn't want to miss out.
So what happened after you arrived, Joanna?
Well, as we got closer to the tomb, we could see the stone was rolled away.
Ah, someone knew that you were coming and moved it for you. So helpful. That was very kind of you, Fred.
Oh, it wasn't me. Actually, I hadn't even got near the tomb yet. I was farther away. To be honest, I was kind of scared to get too close. I thought that if it was true that Jesus was going to come back, he'd eventually go walking right by me. Not he actually would come back from the dead, of course. That's just silly. But if he did.
So, Joanna, the stone was rolled away from the entrance?
That's right. So he just walked in.
Tell us what you saw.
Nothing. There was nothing there.
Well, that's another hard-hitting news story for Channel O News. A woman saw nothing.
Wait. You're missing the point. We went to a tomb where we had laid a body, and then we went back, and there was nothing there at first.
Oh, and Jesus just came walking in? That would be a story.
Actually, no. But two people dressed in white appeared.
Yes, I saw that flash of light all the way from where I was hiding. I mean, waiting.
And did they say anything?
They said that Jesus had died and was risen. Then they vanished again.
Did they walk by or on your way out? And on their way out, Fred?
No, they just disappeared. It was the strangest thing. I mean, I guess it was the second strangest thing considering what other people said.
You heard it here, folks. Strange things have happened in Jerusalem. When we know more, you'll know more. Next up is a story out of Jerusalem.
That's right. I'm here in the home of Jerusalem, where I've managed to catch up with a couple of people who are close to Jesus. They have a story you will not believe, or maybe you will. I don't really know anymore what people will believe. With me are Simone and Lydia. Simone, how long have you known Jesus?
Several years. I heard him speak once, and his vision for what the world could be was so inspiring, I had to learn more. I've been following him ever since.
When you say following, do you mean literally following?
Well, yeah, but also following what he taught.
Where I'm from, we have online learning. It saves a lot of travel time. Maybe you could look into that. But anyway, Lydia, you've also followed Jesus for a long time. What made you join this movement?
Jesus's vision for how the world could be. He talks about God's dream for the world. He makes you believe it just might be possible.
So you were here? After Jesus died? What was that night like?
Quite a few of us had come here just to be together. We were so sad and confused, plus we needed a safe place to hide. The Romans were looking for any followers of Jesus they could find. And with the rumors about the missing body, we had to figure out a plan.
Lydia, what did you see?
Well, we were just sitting quietly, kind of in shock. And then Jesus appeared right in the middle of the room.
And you recognized him?
Oh yes, right away. I know him anywhere. But also, he just appeared in a locked room. Who else would it be?
Did he say anything?
He said,
"Peace be with you. As God has sent me, so I send you. Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained."
Hey, are we doing an interview? Why didn't anyone tell me?
And here's Thomas, late as usual.
Hello, Thomas. I'm Bailey. Were you here when Jesus appeared to his disciples a week ago?
No, I was out checking on some of the others. By the time I got there, everyone told me what had happened, which was crazy. Dead people don't come back, or so I thought.
What changed your mind?
He appeared again, right there while I was standing there.
Did he say anything?
Oh yes, I'll never forget it. He said, "Peace be with you." And then he let me touch him to prove it was him.
Well, that's new. No one else has reported something like that.
That's Jesus for you. Just when you think you have him figured out, he does something new, somewhere you didn't expect it.
Okay, then. I guess that's it for this interview. It seems like Jesus is on the move, and so are his disciples. Back to you, News Desk.
I might need another cup of tea. I'm not sure this is making any sense at all.
You know how it is with breaking news. We report it the way we get it. At Channel Zero News, you can trust you're getting all the news and some things that aren't.
And you know, what better way to watch the news than with a nice hot beverage? I keep mine warm in these limited edition Be the Church mugs, which you can buy at a retailer near you.
But don't rush off to buy one just yet. You won't want to miss this next interview. Senior correspondent Christian is talking to another of the first eyewitnesses, Mary.
Hello, and welcome to Channel Zero News On the Ground Reporting. I'm Christian, the newsman, and I'm reporting live from Jerusalem, where we have another report with an encounter with Jesus. With me today is Mary Magdalene. Mary, how well did you know Jesus?
Oh, very well. I've been traveling with him and his other disciples for quite some time. I know him anywhere.
And you say that you saw him on Sunday morning?
I did. I got to the tomb to say goodbye one last time. Only when I arrived, the rock was rolled out of the way and the tomb was empty. We were sure the Romans had done it.
Why would they do that?
To stop someone else from stealing it, I guess.
So it could steal something so no one else could steal it. Let me see. Nope, nothing else. Someone else is stealing it. That doesn't make any sense.
A lot of things we don't make any sense. They're not the brightest ink in the inkwell, you know.
Now, there were some conflicting stories about what happened that morning. Some people have reported that you were there alone, but others seem to think that you were there with friends. Can you clear that up?
The whole thing was so confusing, I can't exactly remember. Well, I do know that I did see Jesus, though.
And you recognized him. Well, that's amazing. So far, people have mistaken him for someone else.
Oh, well, actually, at first, I thought he was a caretaker. I was so sure someone had broken into the tomb that accused him of doing it. But then he said my name, and I guess, knew.
Just your name? Well, anything else?
Oh, yes, I remember it. He said,
"Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I'm ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God."
And that's it for Channel Zero News Jerusalem. Out next, we have an exclusive interview with Roman Cloud. See you next time.
That's right, I'm here with Antonia, a Roman soldier who was there the night the body disappeared. And Miss Antonia, tell us your side of the story.
Well, I was stationed outside of the tomb for several days. It was a very important job. The whole empire was depending on me doing it well.
And did you do it well?
Yes! I don't know what happened.
Tell us about it.
Well, I was there, except for when I had a few hours off to eat and sleep. Our job was to make sure nothing suspicious had happened.
Suspicious in what way?
Well, there were all these rumors. Apparently this Jesus guy said that he would return from the dead after 3 days. But people were taking him seriously. Something had to be done.
So you were assigned to keep watch, and what did you see?
Well, nothing. No one went in or out of the tomb. It was actually really boring. I kind of thought it would be exciting, but no. Then on Sunday morning, I closed my eyes for just 1 second, and the next thing I knew, people were yelling and running by.
And then what?
That's it. But when I went to the tomb to see if something exciting was finally happening, it was empty. I can't figure out how they did it.
You can't figure out how who did what?
The thieves. I can't figure out how they stole the body. For a second, I thought that that nutty guy actually was right and he did come back from the dead. But that's just silly. So I told everyone what really happened. The body was stolen.
But you didn't see anyone steal anything.
No, but it just adds up. That's the reasonable explanation, and I'm a reasonable person. Okay, well, here you go, folks. The guard at the tomb fell asleep and didn't see anything. More investigative journalism from Channel Zero News. Back to you, News Desk.
And that wraps up today's edition of Channel Zero News, where we will go anywhere and talk to anyone in search of anything.
That's right, from Jerusalem to Tiberias to Emmaus.
From gardeners to guards and eyewitnesses to complete strangers who didn't see anything.
We stop at nothing to bring you the news and our completely unbiased product recommendations.
Signing off for Channel Zero News on Sunday, where we cover it all so you don't have to.
I was halfway up the mountain, and the rocks I held gave way. I came tumbling like an avalanche to the bottom where I lay. And with the taste of blood and the twist of bone, my healing could begin. 'Cause the wound is where the light, the wound is where the light. Wound is where the light gets in. I've stood there like a hostage, the knife held to my vein. Captive to the poison that I took to numb the pain. 'Cause everybody wishes they were born with thicker skin. The wound is where the light, the wound is where the light gets in. It's tricky how the heart works, with the breakups and the big jerks, make you never wanna hurt that way again. Maybe I'm naive, but with every scar I see, place where love is trying to break in. 'Cause the wound is where the light, wound is where the light, wound is where the light gets in. Recognize the same by the scars they don't disguise. You can pick out a real sinner by the kindness in their eyes. So if you're stumbling in the dark and bleeding at the shin, the wound is where the light, the wound is where the light, the wound is where the light. Wound is where the light, wound is where the light gets in.
Holding on to that spirit of prayer and the reminder that God works in all times and places, and that the wound can be where the light gets in. I invite you to rejoin together in the breath of spirit that we began in, and to notice anything that is on your heart today, whether that is a challenge, a worry, a need for healing for a person or a place. And breathe into that space for a moment as we turn to praying together this prayer of the disciples, and it is based off of the prayer that Jesus taught. So let's join in praying in whatever words speak to you today, if there is a way that you know this prayer and words that you prefer to say. Mother, Father, God, in whom heaven and earth are one, you are holy beyond our knowing. May your dream for the world be fulfilled, and may we do our parts in renewing your creation. Give us food for our bodies and souls, and forgive our missteps and mistakes as we seek to forgive others. In times of trial, lead us in your ever-present wisdom, that in all things we may grow in spirit. Amen.
All right, we're going to do song New Life now, and y'all are welcome to stand and sing along if you like.
New life, new hope, Christ has risen, God is alive. New life, new hope, all creation is singing. Sing of empty tomb joy. Open it all to God's blessings. The mystery is here in our midst. Faith gives us eyes to see. New life, new hope. Christ has risen, God is alive. New life, new hope. All of creation is singing.
Sing a stranger's whose voice calls us by name with compassion. Our weeping is ended as love sends us into the world.
New life, new hope. Christ has risen, God is alive. New life, new hope. All of creation is singing.
Sing the breaking of bread. Moving our hearts to know Jesus. Community asks us to share. Love and justice is one. Christ is here today. Love is here to stay. Christ is here.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Karina Doyle. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. I am a member of Church Council, and I'm here with your weekly announcements. The Birdhouse Silent Auction is up. This fundraiser benefits the birds and the Environmental Justice Ministry projects. Each birdhouse was lovingly painted by someone in our UCC Longmont community. Some of them were made by hand as well, and they are works of art. You can find the link to the silent auction in our church newsletters, Mission Possible, Happenings, or on our Facebook page. Be sure to visit and find a new home for your favorite bird friends. The Rocky Mountain Conference wants your input in a strategic visioning survey. Please complete a brief survey, about 10 minutes long, to help identify the greatest needs facing our conference. The link to the survey can be found also in this week's Happenings, and also in Mission Possible's newsletter. We hope to learn where we need to focus our attention and resources over the next 3 to 5 years. This is a completely confidential survey. Your name or the church name is not required. Please complete your responses by April 21st. Walking group is back. If you're interested in joining a group of people to walk around McIntosh Lake, you may do so. Wednesday mornings at 8:45. And you got to be there at 8:45 or else you're going to miss that train. The meeting place is near the playground, McIntosh Lake, Lakeshore Drive, and Harvard. If you have not already done so, please take a moment to fill out the friendship pad using the link in chat. This is a great way to be in touch with clergy and office staff. And if there's any other way that you'd like to connect to this community beyond Sunday mornings, please check out the website or Facebook page. Sorry, this is my sixth take. I've got a puppy and he's just a terror. You can also send a private chat message to UCC Longmont or can contact Reverend Sarah or Reverend Amelia and they'll be happy to speak with you. Cody says hello and we hope you have a wonderful week.
Cats get a lot of attention for making cameos in those videos, and now we finally gave dogs some representation, so that was welcome. You know, I have to say, there has been so much life, and this campus has really been a buzz with the community garden project. On your way out, you're going to want to take a look at that, at all those beds that were made by church members, and every part of that space has brought volunteers, much like the pageant. Intergenerational volunteers have come and put their time in to bring that space to life. It's a space that really didn't have a purpose, and now it does. The birdhouses is another great example of how generosity spanned the ages and allowed folks to paint and create. Some people made the birdhouses themselves, all people painted them. And so I offer that today as our moment of generosity because there has been a lot of life here on this campus. And following our service, we typically have breakout groups on Zoom, but we're also going to have courtyard conversations for the folks who are here. If you'd like to stay for a moment and let the kids play outside, it's time for adult conversation. And we recognize that we're in this weird mix of a lot of people online, a few people here in the congregation, and we hope that the courtyard conversations are a way for people to connect and to regather as a community, because it is in the community of Christ where Jesus appears. That's what many of our stories were about today in the story of the resurrection, is that it's in this community experience that Jesus appears. And that doesn't mean that Jesus doesn't come to our homes and visit us in our own gardens, but it's a unique way that Jesus is embodied in the community of Christ. And we hope that you'll return to experience that firsthand. If you would like to make a financial contribution to the life and ministry of this church, there is a link online, but we also have boxes in the back of our sanctuary. They're affixed to the wall, and you can put your offering in those places. But we also acknowledge that there is an offering of time and talent as well, and an offering of friendship. So however you give, whenever you give, please know that it is received with gratitude.
All right.
Let us go forth into the world, serve God.
As Reverend Sarah mentioned, we have several opportunities for you to connect informally. If you are able to today, you can connect to breakout rooms online, connect with each other.